And joining us on the Rothman Orthopaedics guest line from the Flippin' Bats podcast, folks, if you don't listen, this is the second time this man's been on with us here. Ben Verlander joins us right now. Check out his podcast, Flippin' Bats with Ben Verlander. And also make sure you guys are following him on all social media platforms, including Twitter. Ben, how you been, man?
I'm doing great, man. A lot better than I was like a week and a half ago when baseball wasn't back. But I'm pumped now, and thank you so much for having me on again.
Absolutely. Now, you have a brand new episode of Flippin' Bats coming out. It's a great podcast. You do a phenomenal job with it. It really is. It's just a lot of fun to hear people talk about baseball with passion, which you, of course, do. And you have a pretty interesting guest coming up for your next episode.
Yeah, actually, about to record it tomorrow, and it comes out Wednesday with Mike Soroka, pitcher for the Braves, obviously, who's a stud, and just been an unfortunate last year and a half for him with injuries and stuff, but really excited to do it and appreciate the kind words about the show, man. That's kind of the whole point of all this, is just talking highly about the game we all love and talking about it with passion. So thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely. And I got to admit, and my audience knows this, I have been a baseball first guy my entire life. The most recent reminder of baseball being such a business has kind of spoiled things. And then the Phillies, it's almost like the Godfather, you know, just when I thought I was out, you pulled me back in by going, signing everybody like a drunken sailor. It's just what incredible what the Phillies have been doing. I'm going to go through the whole thing. But overall, Ben Verlander, let me ask you this question. How excited should I be about the Philadelphia Phillies upcoming season?
Look, I think excited. I think they've added some great pieces. I don't know what the current situation is right now with Zach Wheeler, but I mean, obviously a stud last year. I'm hopefully he's okay and going to be great again this year. We know Aaron Nola can be good. And if we can get a little bit better a year, I like the rotation. The bullpen's obviously been a little question mark for a little while now, but what they did offensively is incredible. I'm really excited to, I think they're just going to be a fun team. Like, I feel like what we saw last year with the Blue Jays, where they were just an exciting team to watch. And like, no matter who you were rooting for, you just like to watch the Blue Jays. I feel like that's going to be the Phillies this year. I feel like they're going to be a lot of fun to watch in a really good division. A lot of good games are going to be taking place, and they're going to absolutely rake. And Schwarber and Castellanos are just great personalities. I'm pumped up to watch them, and I think they're going to be really good.
All right, so here's what we're waiting for in Philadelphia. It's been a decade since we've watched playoff baseball in Philly. Playoff seating has obviously been expanded, playoff, you know, all that stuff. So can we watch a playoff team this year with the proverbial, we got to stay healthy, all that stuff out of the way, the obligatory, got to stay healthy. Do you think this team, in the very early goings, way too early predictions, this roster can make the playoffs?
Way too early prediction, I'm going to say yes. I think what, you know, what we saw from last year from Bryce Harper, I think that's him. I don't think that was like an outlier of a year to this point. I think he got comfortable in Philly, and I think he has another MVP caliber year. The guys surrounding him, you know, I think Dave Dombrowski is a GM that wants to win at all costs, and I'm excited to watch them. I'm going to say way too early prediction. Like you said, injuries aside and everything, I'm going to say that they do get in.
By the time we're done editing this interview, it'll be Ben Verlander guarantees Phillies make the playoffs. All right, so there's been some turmoil here, inner turmoil about the lineup. First, I was like, Schwarber needs the leadoff, and I'm like, no, let's back that off a minute. Let's go with Segura to balance out the lefty-righty situation. Here's what I got. Please grade my homework, Ben Verlander. What do you think of this lineup when it comes to the Phillies and what they can offer the fans this season? Gene Segura leading off here, followed by Schwarber. The only thing that kind of bothers me is that I got – our home growth
out of me. One, this is a really good lineup.
okay, good.
Two,
all right.
Two of which would be, I love Rhys Hoskins batting six. And that says nothing about him as a player, except for the fact it talks about how good this lineup is. Rhys Hoskins is an absolute stud. And to have a guy like that in the six hole, I think is awesome and going to be really good for that lineup. You know, I look at, you know, that lineup kind of, and I don't want to compare the two, but I remember the Astros lineup last year when they had like Carlos Correa and Yuli Gurriel, who won the batting title, batting six and seven. It's like, it's just depth, which is incredible to have. This lineup screams depth. And three would be, if Kyle Schwarber doesn't get off to the year hitting hot, you got to put him in the leadoff spot. Because when he was there last year, he was the hottest hitter on the face of the earth. So I agree. I like this right here. But something happened to him in that leadoff spot. So if anything starts off weird, just put him there and it'll be fine.
We'll be looking for that. Anything to jump out weird with Schwarber, we'll definitely look at that. When you mentioned the personalities of Schwarber, you mentioned the personalities of a guy like Nick Castellanos. When it comes to these two guys and how they have hit at Citizens Bank Park, granted, though, a lot of limited situations. Schwarber obviously playing for the Nationals for a little bit there, has a little bit more experience. How much does a hitter look forward to that ballpark that he's absolutely smashed in?
Very much so. And I can tell you personally how much of a how much it means to Nick Castellanos. I had him on my podcast a few months ago, towards the end of the season last year when he was still with the Reds. And we talked about that move away from Comerica Park when he was with the Tigers and then to Wrigley and then to Cincinnati. And he talked about how important playing at a hitter-friendly ballpark is to him. And it's no secret, you know, Detroit, that right center field where Nick hits the ball a lot, he has a lot of power to right center. And it's just huge out there in Detroit. And then he moved to a smaller ballpark and he's like, it really makes a difference. So that's why early in the offseason, when baseball just finished up, I predicted Nick Castellanos to go to the Phillies. One of the reasons is I believe they're built and close to winning. And two, it's clearly a hitter friendly ballpark that he's also hit well in. So I think it was just the perfect storm. I think it's not going to take him long to get acclimated. I think Phillies fans are going to absolutely love this guy. I think he's kind of the epitome of a Philly athlete. You know, he plays with an attitude. He plays, he's passionate, and he absolutely rakes. I think that's a big part of it. And to see two guys that love hitter-friendly parks but that also hit well there, it could be dangerous for those guys this year in that park. I'm excited to watch them.
Some friends of mine own a Greek restaurant that I go to frequently, and they were excited to see Castellanos sign. And I'm like, I made the same mistake. I'm pretty sure he's more of a Hispanic heritage.
Yes, you're right. When I was getting ready to bring him on, when I was bringing him on the show, I went back and forth, and everybody goes back and forth. I mean, I was in the organization when he was there as well. And it's like, he also went back and forth on Nick and Nicholas, by the way, for a long time.
Really? I didn't know that.
There was one game. It was during spring training and we had finished up on the backfields, and I went, and I believe my brother was throwing that day. So I went and sat in the stands, and I was right next to his mom, who literally had like hundreds of flyers that said his name is Nicholas, not Nick, like proceed accordingly. And then like he went by that all year. And then the next year is back to Nick. I'm like, I don't know what to call this guy anymore.
that's hilarious. I can already tell that his mom is going to be boatloads of fun. Like, you know, like other than sitting next to her, I just get the feeling she's going to be like that of like an Ann Iverson. She's going to be like one of those types of parents that we're just really going to enjoy in Philadelphia.
The whole family is great. She's great as well.
Beautiful. They'll fit in nicely with our fan base. So let me ask you about the arms. You mentioned Aaron Nola. You mentioned obviously Zach Wheeler. We'll see what we get from him, but they made a couple of bullpen acquisitions as well. Talking about Yaris Familia as well as Brad Hand, and then Knebel on the back end of that bullpen, who Joe Girardi has already said is going to be a closer for this team. What do you make of the acquisitions to this point when it comes to improving that bullpen?
A couple of them, you know, I like them. It's just like, to me, it adds to the like question mark of consistency with the bullpen, like
taking flyers on veteran arms,
basically. Right? Which seems to be a theme with the team, and you know. I look at Familia, who clearly has incredible stuff, but it's like, are you going to be able to put him in at the end of the game and like count on him to not put guys on base and to get outs? And the answer could be yes. It's just, to me, another question mark there. But then I look at a Knebel, who ended up, you know, starting a bunch for the Dodgers in the playoffs and when they were doing the opener. And I think that speaks volumes to what Dave Roberts thought of him. How good he is, how good he can be. I got drafted. We were in the same draft class, and I played with him at a few levels. And he's a great guy. He's built to close. He's going to throw strikes. I'm really excited about him in the back end. Some of the other pieces I'm excited about stuff wise, but it makes a difference when you can bring those guys in the seventh, eighth, and ninth. You need a closer. You need a closer in that ninth inning spot that you can rely on. It makes a difference when you can bring in those guys like Familia in the seventh and eighth and see, you know, like see where they're at stuff wise. But once you get to the ninth inning, it's a whole different ball game. So I like Knebel being there, and it's just I like taking flyers on other guys, and we'll see how it pays off. They certainly have the stuff to be very successful.
Gotcha. When it comes to the stuff that they've done for younger guys, like Bryson Stott is a young up-and-coming guy, prospect for the Phillies, that is going to be battling Didi Gregorius at the shortstop position in spring training, and that's already underway. How much has the new CBA and some of the things they've worked out after the lockout, how much will that benefit younger players?
I think a lot. I think as we continue, the new CBA that was just signed will be really good for younger players and really good for the game of baseball, in my opinion. I think there's still some things that are going to be tweaked as we go throughout the years, but we've set the framework for how to treat younger players and how to not manipulate their service time. I definitely think there's still some stuff that needs to be worked on there that can help it even more, but we're on the right track. And I think that that's going to help a guy like him. And I think the most famous case of all of this is what happened with Kris Bryant and the Cubs years ago. They literally wouldn't even bring him up until a certain point because of the service time manipulation. And I'm hopeful with these younger guys now, we see them starting the year earlier, especially a guy like Stott, who's expected to be a stud, and I think is going to be really good. You're not hesitant to bring him up at the beginning of the year, because if he finishes, you know, top two and rookie of the year or a top in all these categories, you're rewarded for it. And I think that that's definitely going to help these younger guys. And I'm excited to see, once we get into it, these younger players that I think have a really good chance to succeed at this level, like him, like Stott, like Julio Rodriguez out in Seattle. I think we're going to be able, as a fan, to see them earlier in the season and to see them help the team compete. I think it's great all around.
All right, now, one of the concerns people have for this Phillies lineup, you mentioned the name Kris Bryant. I, at the beginning of free agency and all that, I was like, get Kris Bryant, solves bat order, you know, can rake as well, but it can also obviously field and play different positions. Would you rather go Kris Bryant, or would you rather Nick Castellanos and Kyle Schwarber? If you could have both or one, I'm assuming you'd go for both.
So the question is Kris Bryant or both of the other guys?
Yes, exactly.
I'm going to take Castellanos and Schwarber.
That's what I thought you'd say. Okay.
All day, every day.
How concerned should we be in Philadelphia when it comes to this team playing defense?
It's funny. I was just watching the spring training game, and they made like two errors, and I'm like, oh, God.
Yeah. But, I mean, that Munoz guy, I don't think he's getting a lot of time during the season, just for the record, but yeah.
Yeah, but Segura made one as well as I was watching, but those two guys, you know, it's going to play a factor, it's going to be an issue, but I mean, it's more fun to watch a team that rakes, and it's going to result in more victories.
Okay.
I would say the defense is an issue, but I think the offense is more than capable of making up for that issue.
All right. Coach Long has come in here to be the Phillies batting coach. And a lot of people have talked about how he's got a history with Bryce Harper. He's got a history with the Washington Nationals and all that. One of the things that I'm looking forward to is how he can maybe rebuild a guy like Alec Bohm. How does a hitting coach, of all the ones you've experienced throughout your pro career, how does a hitting coach try to, I don't know, change the mindset or approach of a batter? How can they help you?
Yeah. You know, I can't speak enough to how important it is. I played 5 years professionally and had the same hitting coach for three of those. And I'm not going to throw anybody under the bus here, but it really became an issue for me. In two of my four full seasons, I made an all-star team at the break. And then in the second half, I really struggled and didn't have a hitting coach that I could turn to, which really became an issue for me. And then I got to the point where I did have a hitting coach that actually like cared and was really good. And it makes all the difference in the world. It's just a guy just being there for you that can help you say, hey, this is what you were doing when you were successful. Get back to doing this. And, you know, the best hitters in the world. I remember when I was younger talking to Miguel Cabrera and when I first got into the organization, and he was saying all the time, I just need somebody there that's outside of my brain that's able to say, hey, get back to this. And I think they're Kevin Long is one of the most well-respected hitting coaches in all of the business. I'm really excited to see what this team is able to do under him, because I really feel like that's an underrated part of a team, is having a guy like that, because I can't speak highly enough about having a hitting coach that you spend every single waking second with at a stadium with that is good at what he does. and Kevin Long is great at it. And I'm really excited to watch this team take off with him because it is really important.
Fantastic. And, you know, just for the record, just real quick, can I just get a letter grade from you? Just because I like to pat myself on the back occasionally. And I think the letter grade will be better than actual letter grades I got in actual letter school. So what do you think of this lineup? If you have to grade me letter-wise, what are you giving me, Ben Verlander?
What am I giving you? I'm going to give you, this lineup, I'm going to give it an A minus.
Oh, okay. I'm happy. You said A. That's all I care about. I don't care about the minus. I don't care. Okay, go ahead.
It has more. If Alec Bohm can be the stud that I believe he can be, this lineup has the potential to get up to an A. So I'm going to give your grade a 93 with a 96 potential. You can get extra credit.
Oh, potential is my middle name in school, and I never reached it. And I never reached
it. Was my middle name in my playing career as well. I never reached it either. So,
Ben, would you indulge me with a little quick game here of Fast Five? I got five questions for you. We asked them. It's a new guest. Great. All right. Let me just bring in my band. We got a new band. The budget has just increased since the last time you were on. So here you go. Ladies and gentlemen, Fast Five with Ben Verlander. Here we go. All right. First question. Best job before this job, and you cannot include playing professional baseball. So no podcast, no Fox Sports, no baseball. Best job before baseball. What was it?
That was my only job before the Fox Sports job.
Never a busboy or anything like that?
Well, okay. So I worked for like an in-between year at an events company in Virginia, and we ran like all the major sporting and entertainment events in the state. So I'll say that.
Oh, okay. That's pretty cool gig. All right. Go-to fast food place.
Go-to fast food, Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A is just solid. The people just love that Polynesian sauce. All right, first date deal breaker. I know you're in a serious relationship. If when you're dating days, what's a first date deal breaker?
First date deal breaker. Good question. I'm gonna say, just like no personality, just like very monotone, no personality.
Gotcha. I'm just attractive. Just take me out places, right?
Right.
We've been there, bro. Let me tell you. Oh, my goodness. Favorite city to travel to?
Favorite city to travel to? I'm going to say Denver. I love going to Denver, and I like going to Austin. Can I get that's multiple answers.
No, that's fine. Austin's awesome.
Okay.
I love Austin.
Fun fact, I also really like Philly, and I'm not just saying that. I go there a bunch. And I'm friends with John Middleton, the younger John Middleton.
Oh, okay, yeah.
All right. I go there a bunch. I love it.
Awesome. All right, just feel free to extend the invite. I got two young kids now. We just had our second about 2 months ago. So I'm looking to get out of the house, but no pressure. Okay. That was begging. I'm sorry. Okay.
No,
all right. Here's my favorite question of these five. In traffic, what makes Ben Verlander use his horn? In traffic, what makes you beep your horn?
Two answers. One, I get really like I feel like my personality is great, but when it comes to traffic, I get really frustrated and like really mad when people cut me off or if they don't wave, like if I let them in, like you got to be polite on the road, which is an issue. I realize people aren't. And the other one would be I put on concerts in traffic with myself only. And when it's like a good beat or something drops, I hit the horn. And like it's part of the beat drop.
you beep your horn to the beat of the music?
Yes. Yes. Not when anybody's around. It's like when I'm on the wide open road.
Right.
Know?
No one's around. You're coming
from,
back from a road.
From country back roads in Virginia. Like I could beat my horn all I wanted when the beat dropped. It was great.
Yeah, I'd just love to see you do it between Philly Airport and like Northeast Philly on I-95. How are you gonna fly? Ben Verlander, ladies and gentlemen, if you're not doing it already, I mean, come on, just improve your life a little, ladies and gentlemen, by checking out Ben Verlander on Twitter, as well as checking out his amazing podcast. It does a great job with Flippin' Bats podcast. Really appreciate you coming on, Ben, and hopefully, you know, this postseason guarantee that you had for everyone.
Oh, God. Great.
No, but in all seriousness, thank you very much for coming on. Great catching up with you. Check out Ben when it comes to everything with Flippin' Bats podcast, as well as all social media with Ben Verlander, obviously, on Twitter. Ben, great catching up with you, and thanks for joining us on the Rothman Orthopaedics Guest Line.
Hey, thanks. Speaking of guarantees, I did guarantee that Dave Dombrowski was going to do a couple things on social media during the lockout, and I nailed both of them. Philly people were saying your legacy is on the line, and I came through twice.
Look at you. You're a hero to the people.
I appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me. It's always fun.
Absolutely. Ben Verlander joining us.